us to the service. But we thank you for your presence here today. And we pray you feel the presence of the Holy Spirit today as we worship him. I just call your attention to all the announcements in the bulletin. I hope you look at them each week. There are a lot of lots of information in there. I want to particularly draw your attention to Operation Christmas Child. We're getting close to that, and we need some more things to pack those boxes on November the 11th. So if you would like to participate, there's a list of some things there in the bulletin. And if you want to know more, just call the church office and we can give you that information. But again, thank you for being here. Why don't you stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord today? You do that. And it's on Christ, the solid rock, that we stand. You join as we lift our voices in praise together.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name. I trust the solid rock I stand, on the ground is sinking sand, on the ground is sinking sand. When darkness fails his lovely grace, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, by
Jesus, you join as we continue in worship together.
Only one whose favor I seek. Father, we come to you thanking you, Lord Jesus, for the gift of life. We come to you thanking you for all your promises, Lord, and that your own will never beg bread, Heavenly Father, and you provide for us day in and day out. We want to say thank you, Heavenly Father. This time we pause in our service to give back just a small portion of what you have blessed us with. and may be used for your kingdom, Heavenly Father. And I thank you, Heavenly Father, for my pastor. I ask you to bless him, Heavenly Father, as you break the bread of life to us today, that we'll grow in grace and knowledge of you. Continue to bless this church, Heavenly Father, as we get together as one. I know we in mourning now, because you say weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who rejoice. But we thank you, Heavenly Father, for your promises. They're faithful and true. So bless this time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There's a beautiful spiritual called Steal Away to Jesus. It's about God's calling in our lives. You worship as our instrumentalists lead us. God's grace is truly amazing. We should never take that for granted. You stand and join as we sing about His amazing grace.
Saved a wretch like me. 'Twas grace that taught thy heart to hear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone.
Praise God for his amazing grace. I shared at the early service, I couldn't help but think of this past week. We lost two very special family members in this church. Danny Spinks, who was paralyzed for the last 28 years after breaking his neck, diving into the water. And I was thinking about, we were singing, "My Chains Are Gone," that Danny's walking now. And his chains are gone. Couldn't help but think about Preston Chilton, who went to be with the Lord, a 37-year-old who had battled much of his life, kidney disease and health issues. Preston's chains are gone, and he's been set free. And they're both soaring on wings like eagles, running and not growing weary. They're walking and not being faint. And so maybe you're here today, and you've got some chains that God needs to break, some things that you need to change in your life. You know, if there was ever a time to get our lives together, to get our houses in order, it would be now. I mean, none of us are promised tomorrow. That's why we're to live each day to its fullest, to bring glory and honor to God, to love Him and love our neighbor. And my prayer is today that you'd experience the realness of God's love and that He would radically transform you and transform me to be more like Him in every way. But this altar is open today, and if you feel led by the Spirit of God to come and kneel or stand to pray about anything and everything, I invite you to come join me as we lift up our prayers together. Would you come pray with me today? Oh God, we bow before an almighty God, recognizing that our strength is not enough, but God, that your grace is sufficient and your power is made perfect in weakness. Thank you, oh God, that you are faithful. Thank you that you promise in your word that you will never leave us nor forsake us. You are with us always, even until the end of the age. And Father, this morning we lift up the Spinks family and ask that you would comfort and strengthen them in their great loss. Lord, lift up the Chilton family, that you would comfort and strengthen them in their great loss. And Lord, we know that Preston is celebrating his birthday today with you in glory. And Father, we just thank you for the victory that's been won through Jesus. Father, there are many others kneeling at this altar or praying from their seats or watching on live stream that need a miracle, that need the chains to be broken, that need a newness of life and a refreshment, God, of their faith. I pray that today would be the day that many would come back to you, that many would come to know you as their Lord and Savior. The only hope we have, God, we know, is through Jesus. And I pray, God, for those who are hurting, grieving, those that are recovering from surgeries, facing surgeries this week, going through chemotherapy and radiation treatments. God, we pray for those who have been affected by the hurricanes and still in the pathway. Oh, God, bring comfort and strength and help these dear people, God, to recover and get back on their feet. And Lord, there's some people here today that need to recover, to get back on their feet, to face a new day with the blessed assurance that Jesus is mine and ours. And Father, we just pray today that your Spirit would be thick in this place. I pray, oh God, that you would just continue to move through the beautiful music and through your word and through your servant. May your voice be heard and our lives be transformed. And Father, we just thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for this church, the love we share. Father, for the great things you have done, the great things you are doing, and the great things that are still ahead. We give all the glory to Jesus. And Father, I just pray now that your Spirit would continue to have your way and everything that's said and done, that you would be glorified through it all. In the strong and holy name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 This morning, if you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 1? And as you're doing that, I'm grateful that the choir will be coming to lead us after the reading of God's Word. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for all the beautiful music. This is a great verse that maybe many of you are familiar with, but if it's new to some of you, I pray that you would take it to heart, because there's power in God's word. Verse 18, one verse: "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the word of the Lord, and blessed be the name of the Lord. Thank you, Bill and Choir, for leading us so beautifully. Thank you for being here today on this rainy day, but allowing the Spirit of God to shine brightly in this place. I always like to try to bring a little smile to your face. Last week, I told you that joy was one of the fruits of the Spirit, and I challenged you all to smile. I joked at the evening service last Sunday night. Many folks came out last Sunday. You didn't say a word to me. You just went, just smiled. I love it. So remember that after I tell you these next few things, okay? Now, do you all know how angels, groups of angels in heaven greet one another? Halo, halo, halo. Y'all know who the greatest comedian in the Bible was? Samson, because he brought the house down. Do you know what excuse Adam told his children of why they had to leave the Garden of Eden? Said, your mother ate us out of a house and home. Come on, I'm working hard up here. My last name is Dangerfield, so I get no respect. Anyway, today we read a passage of Scripture that comes out of 1 Corinthians. Paul is writing the church at Corinth that was a gifted church, but they were spiritually immature. They were worldly. As a matter of fact, Paul was addressing some moral irregularities, some divisions that were taking place, some arguments, as well as some immorality. Paul was also addressing some false teaching about the resurrection and abuse of the Lord's Supper. And Paul was writing as a pastor with his church. He had a shepherd's heart, and he was greatly concerned about these problems that the Corinthians were going through. And yet, Paul loved them, and he preached a message really that is centered around the gospel. And he tried to gently restore and instruct these Christians at Corinth on how they could continue to grow in their character and their holiness, reflecting the life of Christ. He said that love of God was greater than man's wisdom, worldly wisdom. And then in this one verse, he centers around the gospel. He centers around the good news of Jesus Christ. He says in verse 18, the message of the cross. The message of the cross. What is the message of the cross? We see the cross on a lot of church steeples or in a lot of churches in the foyers or on the wall or in the sanctuary. What is the message of the cross? Well, the message of the cross is love. Last Sunday, if you were here, we shared Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ Jesus died for us. The message of the cross is love. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. In John chapter 15, verse 13, Jesus said, greater love has no one than this, that they lay down his life for his friend. That's exactly what Jesus Christ did for you and me. Billy Graham, the late great evangelist that I admired and respected so much, you might remember just a few years ago, he passed earlier in the year at age 99, but at age 95, he gave his last address to the nation. You might have seen it on TV, and we showed the video here at church, My Hope America. And at age 95, he said, there is only one message that should change lives and hearts. I want to tell people about the meaning of the cross, he said. Billy Graham faithfully told people about the message of the cross all around the world for years and years. And guess what? When Billy Graham preached on the cross, thousands and thousands of people came to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. When he did not preach on the cross, there were fewer decisions made for the Lord Jesus Christ. evidence that there is power in the message of the cross. Today, maybe you're here and you're feeling like you're not worthy to be loved. You feel like you've messed up in a royal way, that God can never love somebody like you. Well, that's exactly what the devil wants you to believe today. I want you to know today, if you don't get anything out of this message, I want you to know and I want you to believe that God loves you very much. He loves you so much that he would give his one and only son to die on an old rugged cross to save you and me from our sin. The message of the cross is clear. It's love. But the message of the cross is also forgiveness. We all are in need of forgiveness. The message of the cross tells us that we were in need of a Savior. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's Romans 3:23. And 1 John chapter 1, verse 8, it says, if we claim to be without sin, then there is no truth in us. Because we know we all have sin. And Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us of our sins and purify us or cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You know, it breaks my heart that there are people walking around with guilt and unforgiven sin in their lives. I've seen it all through the years of ministry. I've talked with so many people. I've had people to come into my office that when they were a young girl, they had an abortion, and they felt that God would never forgive them, and they couldn't forgive themselves. And I said, although I disagreed with how you handled things, I want you to know that God loves you, and if you confess this sin, he will forgive you. I've had people to come into my office. I had a lady that came in one day, set up an appointment. I'd never met her before in my life. She introduced herself, came in, sat down on my couch in my office. This was the first thing out of her mouth. I'm gay, I'm a lesbian, and I know I'm going to hell, but I just wanted you to know that that's who I am. And I said, well, I want to tell you first right off the bat that God loves you, and I do too, and God will forgive you. The Bible teaches us that we are to love the sinner and hate the sin. We are to repent. That means change of heart, change of mind, change of direction, and we start living in obedience to the Word of God. I've had men and women to come into my office that are married and say, I've had an extramarital affair on my spouse. I can't look at myself in the mirror. I feel so guilty when I look at my wife or I look at my husband. I said, you leave that other relationship, you repent from it, and you do all you can to save your marriage, and God loves you and God will forgive you if you confess your sin. I had a gentleman that came into my office years ago and said that he had so much guilt from being in the Vietnam War that he had killed some people and he could not forgive himself even though he was serving his country. And I said, God loves you and God will forgive you. And I'm thankful that he gave his heart and life to Jesus Christ and I baptized him. But then not too much longer after that, he took his own life because he could not forgive himself. Some of you are here today and you've come into worship and you're trying to sing, but you're carrying a heavy burden. Maybe you've had a drug addiction or maybe you've done some things you're ashamed of. The devil wants to keep you down. He wants to kick you and make you feel unworthy, that you can't ever be loved or you can't ever be forgiven. The message of the cross is God loves you and he forgives you. And there is hope for you and for me. But also the message of the cross is not only love and forgiveness, but the message of the cross for many is foolishness. It says, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. It was hard for these early believers, the Jews and the Greeks, to comprehend, even the Gentiles, that salvation could be obtained through an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame, the worst punishment that could possibly happen to the worst kind of criminal, the worst kind of person, came through an execution on a cross. They had trouble wrapping their minds, the worldly understanding and the worldly wisdom thought it was foolishness that salvation could be obtained through a man who claimed to be the Messiah dying on an old rugged cross. But that's exactly what Jesus Christ did for you and for me. I've shared this so many times through the years, and it's just a great visual of what Jesus did for you and for me. But this chair right here represents the throne of God, God sitting in all of his glory in eternity. I represent all of humankind. I represent the world. And I want to get to heaven one day. I don't want to perish and die. It's foolishness to those that are dying. And you know why it's foolishness? 2 Corinthians 4:4 says, "The little g god of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ." And when Paul said in Romans 12:2, "Do not conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind or spirit," he's talking to us, that we're not to live as the world lives, but we're to be transformed, we're to be changed by the mercy and grace of Almighty God. John writes in 1 John 1:15, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. For anyone who loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." Now, didn't I just read or quote John 3:16, "For God so loved the world"? Well, he's referring to not the created world or the world of people we are to love. He's referring to the world of sin, the realm of sin, the worldly ways. And we read in verse 17 of 1 John 1, that the world and its desires pass away, but he who does the will of the Father will live forever. You know what God's will is? That you and I be saved. That's God's will, that we would all come to know him. Well, I'm here representing the world. Do you remember when God put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden? He said, "You can eat of any tree in this garden." That's how close God and mankind was. "You can eat of any tree in this garden." Remember, they were tempted by the devil. They ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And he said, "If you eat of it, you will surely die." The relationship was broken. And do you remember, that's when sin came into the world. That's when death came into the world. That's when problems came into the world. All through the Old Testament, God tried to raise up prophets preaching to repent and turn back to the one true God. But people worshiped cows and statues and false idols and little g gods, even allowed the world to be destroyed by a great flood in Genesis chapter 9. But then God, through his divine plan, sent Jesus in the form of a tiny baby born of a virgin to Mary, who was brought into this world in a manger in humble beginnings. From the cradle, he would go to the cross, the only perfect person ever to live, the spotless Lamb of God. Jesus came into the world to pay the price that we couldn't pay through salvation. And so this gap, I'm going to try with all my heart to get to heaven on my own strength. I'm going to try to be good enough. I'm going to try to do enough nice things for people. I'm going to try to get there on my own. But the Bible says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Wages of sin is death." This gap where I fall short represents death. Again, that separation. So how can we get to heaven one day? How can we have a relationship with God? Jesus in John 14:6 said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Where we fall short, Jesus made a bridge. To walk over that bridge on the cross, that's so we can have that relationship the way he intended it at the beginning. That's why Jesus came into the world. That's the message of the cross. That seems foolish to those people that are living of the world. And that's what Paul was saying. You all have let too much of the world come into the church. There's to be a marked difference between Christians and non-Christians. We're aliens, strangers, foreigners in the world. If you feel like you don't belong, we don't belong. We're to be the salt and the light in the world, to be a difference maker, to exalt the name of Jesus. And the message of the cross is love and it's forgiveness. It's foolishness to some. But then the message of the cross is power. It's the power of God. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it's the power of God. Paul said in Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. We read in Romans 10:9 that if we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And today, that power, that resurrection power, the tomb is empty. And that same power can transform your life. Do you believe today that God has the power to save you? The answer is yes, he does. Does God have the power to forgive me? Yes, he does. Does God have the power to lift me out of my depression? Yes, he does. Does God have the power to save my marriage? Yes, he does. Does God have the power to break the chains of my addiction? Yes, he does. Does God have the power to heal my sickness or my disease? Yes, he does. Does God have the power to take this grief away from me and comfort me? Yes, he does. Does God have the power to lift me out of my loneliness? Yes, he does. God has the power to do what man cannot do on their own strength. God has the power to radically save you and me when we trust in him. And if you're putting your hope and trust in anything or anybody else, you will be disappointed. You will fail. But when you put your faith and trust in Christ, there's no fault in him. He was the lamb that sacrificed for you and me. It's time for Christians to stop playing church and going through the motions, being like the Christians when we're with Christians, living like the world when we're with the world. It's time to choose this day whom you will serve. To either choose to be on God's team or the world's team. He said, because you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. If you are hot or cold, and it's time to make a choice today. I don't know about you, but I choose God. I choose Christ. And he will never fail you, I promise. He will keep his promise forever and ever and ever. Aren't you ready to accept the message of the cross? Don't think it's foolish. Don't think it doesn't apply to you. It applies to all of us. Today, God wants to save you and change you. Won't you let him as we pray together? Oh God, I pray right now in the stillness of this moment that if there are any men or women or young people here that don't know Jesus, that this would be the day that the message of the cross would transform our lives. Lord, if there are folks here today that have gotten caught up in the ways of the world and they've forsaken their first love, I pray, God, that you would open their spiritually blind eyes, that they might see the light today and grow in wisdom and in truth and in favor with God and man. Lord, maybe there are folks that have been visiting this church and they want to be a part of a church that's not ashamed of the gospel, to preach the truth, but to speak the truth in love. My sin may not be someone else's sin. Someone else's sin may not be my sin, but we are all sinners saved by your grace. And because of your great mercy and grace, I want to live my life for you, and I want to obey your word. That's the way we show you we love you, is by being obedient to your teaching. And oh God, I pray today that our hearts would be convicted and our lives would be transformed, and that this would be the day, because none of us are promised tomorrow, that this would be the day that we experience the beginning of eternal life. Help us, oh God. Give us the boldness to come. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to invite you to stand and come as we sing a hymn of invitation. All you have to do is trust Him. Follow Him. Do it today.
Come every soul, my sin oppressed. There's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you.
Just for a moment, I'm so grateful at the 8:30 service, Elijah Huff, a young man, made a public profession of his faith in Jesus Christ. His parents are Eugene and Suzanne Huff. If you get a chance to send a card or a letter to Elijah, just rejoicing with him, celebrating on his profession of faith. And today is a special day, appropriately, that we should have communion. If you're here and you're a believer, you're a follower of Christ, you know Him as your Lord and Savior, you're invited to partake of this communion. You don't have to be a member of this church. We just want you to be a member of the family of God. And I want to share with you quickly, my youngest, Aunt Catherine, recently accepted Christ and was baptized. And she was excited all week long. She said, Sunday, I get to take communion for the first time. She's been saying it all through the week. And then I ran into Hudson Follis out in the foyer, and he was saying the same thing. He was excited that he gets to take communion. Wouldn't it be great if we all were that excited about taking communion and what it means for you and for me? that the bread represents the body of Christ that was nailed to an old tree, that the blood represents the blood, the cup represents the blood that was shed for the remission of our sins. His love covers a multitude of our sins. Won't you remember what Jesus did as we partake, as our deacons come forward at this time? This time I'm going to ask Phil Roseberry to give a blessing for the bread.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. We just come before you today, Lord, as brothers and sisters. And I reference what the brother said during the offertory prayer, the bread of life. You represent the bread of life for us, Lord. And you said many have eaten manna in this world and they have passed away, but he who eats of the bread of life for the body will live forever, O God. So we do this in remembrance of you, in Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus said, whenever you eat this bread, do this in remembrance of me. And after they ate the bread, they took the cup. I'm going to ask George Bender if you would give a blessing for the cup.
Our Father and our God, we're grateful for this opportunity as we pause before this cup. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your Son and what he did for us. And as he commanded that we should do this in remembrance of him, we ask that the Holy Spirit would be here and guide our memories, direct them to what Christ has done in our relationship with him. Thank you for this cup.
Thank you.
I'm so thankful that God is a God of second chances, and we've been given a second chance through the blood of Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Whenever you drink this cup, do this in remembrance of me. And after they ate, they sang. I'm going to invite you to stand right now and thank you so much for being here today and allowing the presence of the Lord to be in this place. I want to remind you that we will not have our normal evening service tonight. I believe our children and our students will be meeting as normal, but today was Preston Chilton's, would have been his 38th birthday, and Preston had requested a church service for his funeral. So the visitation will be 2 to 6, and tonight at 6 o'clock in this place, we're gonna honor Preston's life, and we're going to bring glory to God for his faithfulness. So keep, again, the family in your prayers, and thank you, church, for allowing the Spirit of God to be here. Bill, if you would close us in a song. Pray that you are glorified in this church today in our lives. And we pray now that how we live outside these walls would be glorifying to you. In Jesus' name, amen.